Huko nilipata huko All right, guys, let's resume. All right, so we were talking about these types of interrupts. Talk about the source of interrupt hardware, software, the periodic or the frequency of the interrupt, periodic and aperiodic. And then we talk about the types of interrupts or classification according to the relationship, the temporary relationship with the system clock. And there we are having synchronous interrupt and asynchronous interrupt. The synchronous interrupt is an interrupt which is in phase to the system clock. In other words, interrupts which are dependent on the system clock. Example, timer service that uses the system clock. Synchronous interrupt is an interrupt that actually works together with the system clock, and it is dependent on it. It is dependent on it, meaning that if it is scheduled to happen at 11:50, or right now it's 12:34, if it's scheduled to happen at 12:50 and produce a pop-up notification at 12:50, basically it will be, that one will be controlled by the system clock. That's what we call a synchronous interrupt. It works together with the system clock. Then asynchronous interrupts are independent or not in phase to the system clock. All right, and especially aperiodic interrupts are asynchronous interrupts. They just happen at any time. They do not check the system clock. They are independent from the system clock. They happen at any time. But those ones which you can schedule, or they happen like after every 30 minutes, after every 30 minutes, for sure, those are working as controlled by the system clock, and they are called synchronous interrupts. So we can actually say periodic interrupts are synchronous in nature. Why synchronous? Because they are governed by the system clock, because it is the same clock that determines what time the notification is going to pop up, okay, or what time that activity is going to happen. Asynchronous, and we can also say a periodic interrupts are asynchronous in nature. because they don't depend on the system clock to happen. They just happen when there is need. Okay. They just happen when there is need. Okay. Now, how does the computer handle interrupts? How does the computer handle interrupts? Now, for the computer to handle interrupts, there are some things that will have to happen. The first thing that will happen is that, first of all, a signal, whether it's a hardware or a software interrupt, a signal has to be sent to the CPU, okay? And then that signal, the processor will check for that signal to check if it is a valid interrupt, okay? Then when the processor ensures that it is a valid interrupt, what does it do? The processor triggers, right? The processor will trigger an interrupt handler, okay? Now, basically, an interrupt handler is an algorithm, okay? Just a programmed algorithm. It's an algorithm that handles or manages interrupts in different ways, as we are going to see here below how interrupt handlers manage interrupts, okay? Basically, interrupt handlers are, it's an algorithm within the CPU, which the CPU uses to manage interrupts. So, number one, a signal is received from the hardware or the software that is generating that input. It is received by the CPU. The CPU checks if it is a valid interrupt. If it is a valid interrupt, just means, is it an interrupt? Can it decode that interrupt, okay? If it converts it to bit level, can it actually decode it? If it converts it to bit level, can it know what kind of interrupt it is, okay? And every kind of interrupt has a number. The operating system generates an automatic, it auto-generates an automatic number for an interrupt. Therefore, the processor picks the interrupt, decodes it, and recognizes it using that what? And the auto-generated number, because everything the CPU handles, whether it's data or instruction, that data or instruction has to have a kind of a number. That particular number is normally a hexadecimal number, okay? To recognize it in the memory and also to recognize it during processing. Okay, so an interrupt is received by the CPU from the hardware and software. Then because it has an auto-generated number, it is decoded to bit level. The processor decodes it to bit level to know that it is actually a valid interrupt, to know which number it has, to know what kind of interrupt it is, okay? And then after it validates the interrupt, then it does what? It triggers, the CPU then triggers an interrupt handler, and the interrupt handler is an algorithm, all right? An algorithm, it is a non-user algorithm, it is a system algorithm, it doesn't require user intervention, it is programmed within the CPU, okay? So the interrupt handler is triggered. Why is it triggered? So that it can now manage the interrupt that has been identified, okay? So the handler will then save that interrupt in a register, okay? It will save that interrupt in a register, and then from there it can now do what? It can now manage the interrupt in the ways in which we are going to see. So remember, how does the CPU receive or manage an interrupt? Number one, the hardware software generates the interrupt, the CPU receives that interrupt, and because the operating system has auto-generated a number, a hexadecimal number for every kind of interrupt for the CPU to recognize, the CPU decodes that number. After decoding it, then it is deemed a valid interrupt. After being deemed a valid interrupt, it is the CPU auto-triggers. It triggers an interrupt handler. And an interrupt handler is an algorithm or a system program that manages an interrupt when the CPU, triggers it, okay? So let's see now how the interrupt handler handles or manages interrupts, okay? There are two ways in which it manages interrupts. There is what we call the first level interrupt handling and the second level interrupt handling. Now, what is first level interrupt handling? This is a kind of interrupt handling that handle maskable interrupts. Okay, this is a type of interrupt handling that handle maskable interrupts. It's a basic kind of interrupt handling management scheme. Okay, first level interrupt handling, it handles maskable interrupts. So after the interrupt handler has been triggered, then it will check, number one, is it a maskable interrupt? Is it an interrupt it can ignore? Can it continue? Can the CPU continue with other processes and this interrupt can actually be ignored and given a lower priority? If it is, then this is called a first level interrupt handling, okay? Normally for maskable interrupts. But if that interrupt is of high priority nature, and therefore what that means is that all the executions that are in already taking place have to be paused or stopped for this interrupt to be addressed, then those kind of high level interrupts are handled in this manner, the second level interrupt handling. So that is now what we have in interrupt handling. Okay, we have first level and second level. Okay, so when the handler has been triggered, it will check whether it's a maskable or a non-maskable. If it's an interrupt that it can keep on hold, it can keep on hold, so, and the current executions can still continue, then that is what we call a first level interrupt handling mechanism or scheme. And then if it is an interrupt that pauses everything, then it is a second level interrupt handling. Okay. Now, why are we saying that the first level interrupt handling is fast? We are saying it is fast because it does not require a lot of intervention it's not an intensive algorithm, okay? Because it can keep the interrupt on hold. But when we are talking about second level, we are talking about a soft or slow. Why is it soft or slow? Because the process of handing over priority from a current execution that is already running to another execution that has to be started, that particular kind of process is an intensive process. Why? Because the process that has been running, all processes that are running currently, they have already been given a time slot in the CPU. So how do we eject an activity from the time slot of the CPU and introduce the interrupt into the time slot so that it can be given priority? Because when we are talking about prioritization, or what we call job scheduling or processor scheduling, as you discussed in operating systems, I believe you discussed that in operating systems, we are basically talking about how the processor handles activities and gives them, the operating system handles activities and gives them to the CPU for processing. So we are saying that this particular scheme of interrupt handling is slow because it is an intensive process, removing or ejecting one of the activities from the CPU that is already in execution and introducing an interrupt into that time slot. All right, so it can use a first come, first serve, a last in, first out, a first in, first out, or such kind of things. Okay, so it's an intensive algorithm because remember, there is already a process that is already occurring. There are program threads. I think you talked about these terms in operating systems. There are program threads that are already in execution, and there is an interrupt that has to be given priority. So what that means is that these program threads have to do what? They have to be auto-ejected, right? So that particular method of auto-ejecting program threads from the time slot and introducing an interrupt, it's actually an intensive process. That's why we are saying that the second level is slow. Okay, it is slow. All right, anybody with any question on interrupts? Anybody with any question on interrupts before we move on? We're also trying to save time because of the session only allows for 40 minutes. I believe we've actually spent 10 minutes already, I think. Right? Okay. I'm going to move on then now to chapter 3. So we have done chapter 1, introduction to computer system architecture. Chapter 2, we have done input and output. And chapter 3, now we are dealing with memory. We are now dealing with memory. So I'm trying to multitask as I admit people that are joining us. So chapter 3, we'll talk about memory and how it is organized and how it logically works, right? All right. So let's begin by defining what computer memory is. A memory is just like a human brain, and its work is basically to store data, to store information, to store instructions, and it can either be permanent storage or temporary. Okay, it can be permanent or temporary. So basically, we know that the random access memory, is a temporary storage location. When you discussed operating systems or introduction to computers, you discussed primary memory, secondary memory, and you saw that primary memory is basically the RAM, the random access memory. Its work is to temporarily hold data and instructions before and after processing. So the key word there is temporary. Okay. So it stores temporarily. Okay. So when we are going to be dealing with microcomputer memory, here we are actually discussing the RAM. Okay. So we are having RAM in focus. But of course, we are going to discuss other types of memory. This is also where we are going to discuss RAM in relation to other kinds of memory. So you're going to realize we are going to get into something called memory hierarchy, where we're going to discuss other types of memory. Okay. But we have the RAM in focus. Okay. So that is basically what we are having. So the RAM is the temporary storage location and it's the primary memory for the microcomputer device. And basically, the memory is divided into large number of small parts called cells. All right. So just a minute. Okay. The memory, the RAM, is divided into small parts called cells. Each cell has a unique address, and these addresses, they range from 0 to memory size minus 1, okay? From 0 to minus 1, meaning that there are different other units. Between 0 and 1, there are very many, many units, 0.1, 0.2. Between 0.1 and 0.2, there are many, 0.11, 0.12. Between 0.11 and 0.12, there is 0.111, 0.112. What that means is that between 0 and 1, why are we saying 0? They will vary from 0 to 1 because there can only be two binary forms, 0 and 1. The computer system only understands language that is binary in nature, discrete binary digits, zeros and ones. So they only range from 0 to 1. And in between, they are going to be having smaller notations, decimal notations. So each location has a unique address. Okay, so it can be a 0.11 or a 0.12 or a 0.111 or a 0.112. In other words, it is never minus 0 and it is never plus 1. It is always 0 to 1. Okay. All right. So these cells are the ones which actually store data. Okay. So the cells are the ones which store data. Now cells are not physical positions, they are logical. Okay, they are logical. The computer understands them logically. You cannot see them. When you hold a RAM, you cannot see the cells. All right. When you hold a RAM, the only things you will see are the the IC chips. You know, those black things, as we discussed the IC chips from last class, you will only see the IC chips. But as you are saying, the cells are logical. They are logical storage units, okay? They are logical, not physical. You can't see them. They are not visible. They are not tangible, okay? So any memory system, whether it is a RAM or a cache memory or a buffer or even the hard disk, any memory system will have particular characteristics. So these are the key characteristics of memory devices or memory systems. So here we are discussing basically the RAM, okay, or memory units, all right? But any memory system will have the following characteristics: location, capacity. I hope that you are having this thing somewhere where you are noting them down, all right? It's important. Location, capacity, unit of transfer, method of access, performance, physical type, physical characteristics, and organization. So if I ask you, what are some of the characteristics of a memory device or a memory unit, or I ask you the characteristics of a hard disk, all right? So this, you're going to discuss the characteristics in light of these concepts. Location, you discuss. Capacity, you discuss. Unit of transfer, you discuss. And that way, okay? So if I ask you three characteristics of a RAM, you will tell me any of these. So where is it located? How much is its capacity? What is the unit of transfer? What is the access method, right? How does it perform? What's its type physically? What are its physical characteristics? And how is data in it organized, all right? So these are normally the key concepts that describe the characteristics of any memory system. So let's begin with location. Location basically deals with the location of the device in the computer system, all right? So there are three ways in which we can discuss the location of a memory device. Number one, location in comparison to the CPU, location in comparison, internal location, and external or secondary location. So location in comparison to the CPU, this is where we are talking about CPU registers and small amounts of cache memory. These are kinds of memories that work together or in tandem with the CPU. As if the CPU processes, they are also actively engaged in holding data and instructions temporarily after processing and before. So they are there. So when the CPU wants to do data management, it uses some kind of memories that are easy to reach, like the registers. It's a high speed. A register is a high speed memory device or memory media, memory unit. Okay, so in reference to the CPU, we only talk about registers and cache. Okay, but all the other kinds of memories, they are either internal or external. So internal memories, those are the ones that are inside the computer mounted on the motherboard, like the RAM. We have the RAM. We also have the ROM. A type of a ROM is a what? The CMOS, the complementary metal oxide semiconductor, is a type of a ROM. It is mounted on the motherboard, all right? And basically the CPU can directly access the main memory, all right? So the main memory is basically the RAM or the ROM, okay? Then external or secondary memory, this is basically memory, other storage devices like hard disks, magnetic tapes, magnetic disks, and these are basically memory units or memory media that do not have direct access to the CPU, all right? They do not have direct access to the CPU, but there will be what we call the modes of transfer. So the modes of transfer that we talked about from the previous class, the three kinds of modes of transfers are the ones that are going to be used for these kinds of devices. So For instance, if we discuss the RAM, location of the RAM, you're going to tell me the RAM is internal. It's an internal kind of memory. Hence, it has direct access. If I tell you to discuss the hard disk in terms of its location, you're going to say it's an external or secondary. Now, external does not mean it's outside the computer, because the hard disk is not outside. The hard disk is also mounted on the motherboard. It's actually not mounted on the motherboard, but it's inside the system unit. Okay, of course, it has its own separate area. It's not really on the motherboard, but basically, it is inside the system unit. But to say that it is external does not mean that it is outside. It's still inside. The basically, internal or external, basically, is a description of whether the CPU can directly or indirectly access it. Okay? So, external hard disk, magnetic tapes, magnetic disk, they are external or secondary, meaning that the CPU cannot directly access them. All right, they have to be accessed through other means, okay? But internal memories are those which work with the CPU directly, like the RAM works with the CPU directly, the ROM works with the CPU directly. Like the ROM is the one which, a type of ROM is the CMOS, as I've said, the CMOS, the complementary metal oxide semiconductor battery. And the function of that semiconductor battery is basically to do what? Is to keep time. All right, and of course, other functions like booting, right? It also has the BIOS function for booting, but also time, which is very significant, the system clock. It is the CMOS that keeps and monitors. It is the CMOS that keeps the system clock, okay? So that's a very, very key element. The CPU uses the system clock to know when to process activities, okay? So location, so that's how we discuss the characteristics of a memory device, basically according to location. Then there is also the characteristics of a memory device according to capacity. The capacity is the carrying power or the amount of data, the amount of instructions a memory media can hold at a particular time. And it is normally measured in terms of, the capacity is measured in terms of word size, okay, or number of words. What is word size? Words are basically expressed in bytes. A byte is a group of 8 bits. Okay? A byte is a group of 8 bits. A bit is a single binary digit like 0 or a 1. So if you have 1101, 1010, that is a byte. And that is a byte is a word. All right? Okay? But also a word can mean any number of bytes. So basically, a word is a byte or a group of bytes. A byte, one byte, is a group of 8 bits, okay? So basically it can be 1 byte, 2 bytes, 4 bytes, 8 bytes, and such kind of things, okay? 1 byte is 8 bits, 2 bytes is 16 bits. In other words, two groups of eight and eight. 4 bytes is 32, meaning 4 groups of 8, okay? 8 bits. The number of words, this specifies the number of bytes available in the particular memory device. Now, number of words is basically the amount of storage already in that memory media. For instance, if you say that this hard disk has 47.9 GB free of 100 GB, 47.9 GB free of 100 GB. What does that tell you? That there is 52.1 GB of data in that hard disk. So 52.1 GB is therefore what? The number of words. The number of words specifies the number of words available in the particular memory device. Okay? Yeah? So if we say that also, it describes it. So one, it describes the amount of data already in it, and also the amount of data that it can hold. All right, conventionally, like if we say that a flash disk has a carrying capacity of 16 GB. So 16 GB is the number of words it can carry. Why? Because 16 gigabytes. Those are words. Because words are described in terms of byte form, right? 16 billion bytes, okay? 16 billion words, okay? So word size is basically an expression of bytes. And the number of words is how many words, how many bytes that media, you know, that media can actually hold. Are we together? All right. Then the unit of transfer, it is the maximum number of bits that can be read or written into the memory at a time. So in case of main memory, it is mostly equal to word size. In case of external memory, unit of transfer is not limited to the word size. It is often larger and is referred to blocks. So unit of transfer is basically how many number of bytes can be transferred in one single time. Okay. And the time can be measured in form of a second or a microsecond. Okay. That's how the system clock reads time, seconds or microseconds. Of course, nanoseconds is for supercomputers and all that, but for normal computers, seconds and microseconds. So how many, for instance, if you are copying, a file, music, from your computer, or you've gone to buy a movie outside there, yeah, and you've gone with your flash disk. So as they copy, as that person copies the movies from their computer to your device, to your USB device, the number of bytes that can go into your USB at every second or microsecond is what you call the unit of transfer, okay? But that one cannot be, it can actually be read. For instance, if you are downloading something using IBM, it can actually tell you 16.7 MB per second. Yeah, 100 MB per second. So basically, that is a unit of transfer. How many words, how many number of bits and bytes can be read or written into the memory at a time, okay? Access methods, this is the method used to access the data items in that memory media. And there are different three types of access methods. We actually have 4 minutes, so I'm going to actually finish this. I create another session. So there are three methods of access, whether it's a flash disk or a hard disk or a RAM, whichever memory system, there are three methods. There is random access, serial access, and semi-random access. Random access is that if storage locations in a particular memory can be accessed in any order, and access time is independent of the memory location accessed. Now, the RAM uses this access method. Also, magnetic disks, magnetic tapes, optical disks, optical disks or optical tapes, and flash disks, they also use the random access. Some of them, they use the random access. Random access is basically if the storage locations in a particular memory can be accessed in any order. There doesn't have to be a particular order, okay? In any order. Then serial access, memory locations can be accessed only in a certain predetermined sequence. So here we have magnetic tapes, CDs, DVDs, and such things. And semi-random is the one that combines both random and serial. Random is orderly, random is unorderly, inorderly, in other words, haphazard, and serial is orderly. So semi-random is a combination of haphazard and orderly. And here we have memory devices such as hard disks, okay? They use this semi-random access, okay? So remember these methods of access. You remember the RAM uses a random access. Data bits can be accessed from it in any order based on the priority given to that item in whichever cell it is stored in. And serial access, it can be accessed only in a certain predetermined sequence. And semi-random access is normally a combination of both random and serial, okay? Can see we have less than a minute, so let's see if we can finish up this. So performance, this is the performance of the memory system determined through three parameters. access time, memory cycle time, and transfer rate. Access time is basically the time taken by memory to complete a read-write operation from the instance that an address is sent to the memory. How much time does it take for you to click on a file? If you have a flash disk connected, how much time does it take for you to, from the time you click on a file, open, how much time does it take for the system to do what? To complete that operation. That operation is a read operation, okay? So how much time does it take for the system to do that? That is what we call an access time. Also, how much time does it take for you to copy a file from one place to another? That time is called the access time, and copying is a write operation, okay? Or cutting or moving. And what is memory cycle time? It's only for the RAM, and it is the sum of the access time and the additional time required before the second access can commence. So this is the time between one access and another, okay? And transfer rate, it is the amount of time that it is taken for you to transfer an item from one memory unit to another. You can see our time is over. So I'm going to create another session.